Howdy, folks. This is the continuation segment of Part 7 series, discharging operation of LPGC cargo operation. This is now Part 7D. And in this scenario, we will be discharging cargo, utilizing, of course, the centrifugal deep well cargo pumps. And, of course, at the same time, we have been required by the terminal and the charterer to discharge at positive 10 degrees Celsius because the terminal cannot receive refrigerated cargo or cold cargo. And nearby, we are applying the so-called cargo heater in series with the discharge centrifugal pump. So in this scenario, of course, first thing that we can do is that we have to drain the make sure that the shell tube casing are drained so there is no condensation inside, because we will be passing cold cargo in there and it might freeze up and you will have a problem, right? So first we have to make sure that it is drained, and now it's drained, then we can open the supply of seawater. We can also go to the cooling water system. As you can see, it's open. And make sure that the overboard discharge valve is open as well. And of course, the supply or seawater pump. Now we can start the pump. So in here, we can see now that there's a water flow going in and going to the cargo heater. That means to say there is a supply of seawater. This is the first thing and very important thing to do. You do not start the cargo first and then you start the seawater. You start with the seawater first, supply for the cargo heater. Then we line up. We open this one. Open. Now take note, there is no physical contact but only thermal contact in between or inside the shell. So warmer region goes to colder region. So the principle are just the same with heat exchangers, as they called, or also the cargo condensers. They are basically have the same principle but different application. In this scenario, we are heating the cargo. So now we are, as been told by the terminal, to start at slow. So we crack open a bit the discharge pump, and then we open a little bit the circulation. Now we start. So there you go. Oops, sorry. Right, so now it's running. Cargo pump port side and tank number one is running. So we go back to manifold and make sure that we are discharging at the required temperature. So in this scenario, this bypass valve will have the vital role of mixing or controlling the discharge temperature. It is most advisable that the bypass should be the one to be throttled than the discharge opening of the cargo heater, because you are only making a bottleneck and you will create pressure. And you have to check your manufacturers. But at no point in time that the supply of seawater should be throttled, should be fully open at full rate. So again and again, this goes on until they, of course, notify us again to increase. So we start also on number two pumps, starboard side. Then we can close the circulation valve. And again, you go back to manifold, because your officer or the crew are standing by giving us a reading. And likewise, oh, sorry, I forgot to open this one. And the manifold. You can disregard some of the instruction that I have mentioned a while ago. This should be open earlier and line up. I just forgot to show it. Alright? So, right. So if we trace the line, cargo pipelines from here, discharging all the way to the manifold, and to the manifold, it goes to your heater. And then with the bypass valve, you are controlling the temperature. So you just have to play with that bulb until you meet the required temperature. And of course, again and again, till they require you to go to your maximum discharging rate. And that's the time that you can increase more of your bulb opening. Right. A little bit more, perhaps, maybe 50%, depends on your pumping system. All right. So this will be the same likewise with your other tanks, until you are in full discharge rate mode. Of course, taking into account your required temperature. This, of course, every time you increase flow, this temperature will change because of the flow in the cargo heater, the heat exchanging. Alright, so warmer region goes to colder region, and so the temperature will become warmer. And there you go, you are discharging in series with the cargo heater. So, please comment down below if you have other questions. Of course, now, if you ask me, tube type heat exchangers or cargo heater are mostly utilized or used in LPG ships. Because while in cargo condensers, some are tube type and some mostly are plate type heat exchangers. So I think it's, yeah, I think it's about the costing and the maintenance. So that's why you'll find the cargo heater of this type on board LPG ship, fully refrigerated. The same thing with fully pressurized, you'll find cargo heater as well. And some are not fitted, but some are also fitted, depending on the cargo type that they are carrying and the trade route their ships are into it. Whether fully pressurized, semi-pressurized, semi-refrigerated, and fully refrigerated, it has a cargo heater. Otherwise, some fully pressurized doesn't have a fitting of cargo heaters because they just because of their trade route, and it was designed to just carry this cargo, and that receiving terminal likewise is just capable of receiving the ambient temperature, but with different cargo, colder temperature, and they might require to have a cargo heater. All right. Now, with regards to the utilization or application of booster pumps, it's basically the same. They are in series with the system. So let's just undermine this so-called cargo heater. But of course, there is also a combination of booster and heater at the same time. So in this case, we can actually open the discharge valve of the so-called booster pumps. And the booster pump can only be started when there is already a flow. Do not make sure that you do not start the booster pump. Basically, the pumps needs some sort of a primer, because it's centrifugal pumps, and you don't want to have them running with no liquids at all. So that's why the cargo tank's pump should not be throttled in a way that the pressure discharge goes down or the flow is slow. Should be in full blast, so it will be the booster pump will control the discharge pressure, not the cargo tank's pump. So now that you are ready, then of course you can start. So let's say we start one pump, and we just start closing the circulation valve, right, until you meet the required discharge pressure. And in this case, in this scenario, we are still using the cargo heater, so it should be okay. Right. But of course you have to adjust as well, because you are now using a cargo booster pump and the flow will become faster. Now, booster pumps of course are utilized especially when the back pressure is too strong and we cannot discharge. It's like you are pushing against a wall. So booster pumps are utilized, and especially with the long distances of storage tank or receiving tanks, it will create a lot of back pressure in the manifold. So booster pumps are utilized. So now once you are stable, then you can close this one fully. But you might as well have a circulation if you want to. Depends on how you will be able to meet up the required discharge pressure. And likewise, if a combination heater, then the same thing. Once you are reaching to the end of the discharge period, again, the last one that will stop will be the cargo pumps, and the discharge pump will follow. Or they can go at the same time, provided that you know that the lines are already empty. There's nothing in it. So make sure that they are stopped simultaneously or at the same time. So there you go. Stripping cargo. As the levels of liquid get closer to stripping, the discharge valves must be throttled towards closing position. The so-called NPSHA, or net positive suction head available, is becoming small every time the liquid level goes down. Eventually, as it goes down, more gas bubbles will be produced because the pressure in the eye of the cargo pump's impeller has a lower pressure than that of the vapor pressure in the cargo tanks. Hence, the pumps wobble and start to cavitate and likewise lose suction. With this condition, closing the discharge valve will stabilize it. This is a critical period where you don't want to lose entirely your discharge suction and positive discharge pressure. The discharge valves can be closed entirely and reopening a bit to build suction. This can go on for a while till the pumps have just had enough. Likewise, if your tanks are of prismatic type with a bulkhead, the pumps on each side are separate with a common leveling valve. The leveling valves has to be closed eventually so that each pump draws from its own pump sump. Eventually, either one pump, port or starboard, may stop first till your stripping of cargo is completed. Centrifugal deep well cargo pumps generally works in the same principles. However, reading your pump's manual, the performance curve diagram, its specification and operation parameters will help you determine the best approach of its usage from starting of discharge till stripping cargo levels. Check on the other video segment about centrifugal pumps and even AUS, or automatic unloading system, for oil tankers to know more about Bernoulli's principles, centrifugal pumps, and the NPSHA. Following up next, discussion part C, managing tank pressures.